Chapter 18 of Mr. Wicker's Window. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Ellie. Mr. Wicker's Window by Carly Dawson. Chapter 18. It was perhaps as well that Chris had more than enough to think of. Otherwise, the wrenched leaving home might have been even more distressing than it was. His last day passed like a flash, though from his attitude no one, certainly not Becky, would have guessed that the next morning he would not be there to eat his breakfast in the sunny kitchen window. Amos, quick to sense all Chris's moods, knew something was afoot, and when Chris and Mr. Wicker finally told him of the sailing plan, Amos's eyes grew rounder than ever and sparkled more brightly, but he never said a word. At 10 o'clock that night, when Becky had gone heavily to her room, wondering perhaps why Chris had given her so hard a hug, Ned Cilley knocked at the back door. He had brought a light cart on which there stood a large wicker hamper. Ned and Chris lifted it into the kitchen while Mr. Wicker drew the curtains and then held a candle high. The candlelight flickered and flapped like a trapped bird at the corners of the room, and sharp, bird-wing shadows cut across Mr. Wicker's tall figure. Yet to Chris, who was to hold the scene ever after in his memory, the kitchen by the light of that one candle and the figure of his master standing in its center, moved Chris, as he had never been touched before. Amos stood near the basket, looking first into its square depths, filled with shadow, and then up inquiringly at Mr. Wicker, who did not speak. "Be of good heart, Amos," Mr. Wicker said to him kindly, "and look after young Christopher as best you can." Then, at a gesture from Mr. Wicker, Amos, agog, stepped into the hamper, where he stood uncertainly, his expression half terrified and half delighted. "Yes, sir, I will," he piped up, shrill with excitement. "I will keep an eye on him," he promised, and then curled up in the hamper. Ned Cilley shut down the top, and he and Chris lifted it to the cart. Mr. Wicker spoke low into Ned's ear. "All is well understood?" he queried. "This is no time for misunderstandings." "Aye, sir, all is clear," the good Ned replied. "Then Godspeed to you all, and bring you safely home," said Mr. Wicker, "and be on the lookout for this lad, Ned, when you get past the bar." "We shall," Ned whispered back, "and good luck to the two of you." Clucking to his horse on wheels covered with rags and with cloth above the horse hoofs to deaden their sound, Ned Cilley and his hamper went quietly away in direction of the wharves. In a moment, cart, horse and driver were swallowed up in the denseness of the night. A black night it was indeed, although there was a moon, thick clouds scudded over it, and an autumn wind bent the trees, tearing the leaves from them. The mist rose from the river, but it was blown away from all but the most sheltered places. Mr. Wicker and Chris stood in the silent kitchen. Looking about him, Chris remembered with a bang the first morning he had seen it, with Becky in her gaudy hat, standing near the fire. "Come, Christopher," Mr. Wicker bade him, taking up his cat-black cloak and another one for Chris. "First, wind the rope about your waist, and once on board, bind it to your shirt. Let no one, not even Amos, know of it." Chris did as he was told. Mr. Wicker then gave him a leather pouch hung on a cord. "Here are some oddments of magic that may prove their usefulness," he remarked. "Wear them around your neck." So saying, he slipped the leather cord over Chris's head.
"What happens to the rope and pouch when I change my shape, sir?" Chris asked.
"They will remain with you. Have no fear of that," the magician replied. "What would be the use of magic if it proved unable to adjust itself?" A smile played over Mr. Wicker's face. "So, all is ready," he said, glancing around. "Now we must be off, and lose no time, for we have much ahead of us," said Mr. Wicker dryly, blowing out the candle. Before he knew it, Chris stood, until what far off time, outside Mr. Wicker's house. His master locked the door. The wind, swooping down like a great bird, tugged at their cloaks and chilled their faces. Chris led the way to the creek and the marsh. This time both he and Mr. Wicker wore high boots, which kept the icy water and mud from their feet.
"What wouldn't I give for a flashlight?" Chris muttered as they came to the marsh.
"Yes, the 20th century has many conveniences," Mr. Wicker replied. Chris could imagine behind him the man's sardonic smile and amused eyes. They came out suddenly from the blackness of the woods to the wind-whipped river, and though the moon was still obscured, the river held a pallid sheen of its own that gave a little light. There was not a sound to be heard but the hurried lap of water against the shore, the suck and pull of Chris and Mr. Wicker's boots in the mud, and sharp, hair-raising rustles from time to time in the reeds. Chris's heart thudded in his throat at these furtive noises, for they could only be made by rats or water snakes, and Chris liked neither of these,
especially at night. Pushing along the marsh edge and feeling their way, the two figures at last came in sight of their goal. The high dark hull of the Venture rose above the water, an amber lantern hanging at her stern. The wind swung the ship, and the tide, still flowing up the Potomac, showed that the bow, held by the anchor, was pointed somewhat downstream. "The anchor may have dragged," Chris whispered to Mr. Wicker. "Now for our boat." The rope seemed to uncoil from about his waist almost by itself, and with the gestures he had been taught, Chris formed a very adequate craft. A trifle lopsided, it must be admitted, as he had had small practice, but seaworthy nevertheless. "I shall see that the men sleep soundly," Mr. Wicker murmured. "You do the rest."
"I shall, sir," Chris agreed, and then the moon showed an edge for a moment in the clouds. "Look, sir, the Mirabelle."
Toward sleeping Georgetown, for it was nearly midnight now, a whiteness showed itself, close against the distant wharves. The Mirabelle was edging out, and Chris knew that Ned, Bowie, Edna, Cloud, and others were pulling her by the ship's boats into the main flow of the river. Once turned, she would float noiselessly down the Potomac past the Venture, and once he was aboard, would hoist her sails and set her course to sea.
"Then quick," bade Mr. Wicker. "We took too long. It seems we are a trifle late."
They stepped into the boat, each taking an oar, and with only a few strong pulls came alongside the silent Venture. They moored their boat to the anchor rope. Mr. Wicker touched Chris by way of wishing him luck and disappeared. For half a second more Chris waited. No sound came from the ship, but a light showed in the captain's cabin. In a twinkling, a monkey with a pouch around his neck ran up the anchor rope and, pausing at the gunwale, sniffled at the pungent flower smell that it now knew meant sleep for all the sailors. Then it pounded toward the light. A window of the cabin on the lee side had been left open, clinging to a piece of rigging before it sprang to the sill. The monkey's eyes caught what seemed to be a shadow darker than that of the mist, of the night, moving away from the sailors left at night watch. A man now lay slumped in sleep, and the same heady scent of spices and flowers that had overcome Chris when he had first entered Mr. Wicker's shop blew away on the gusty fall wind. The ship tugged and strained at her anchor, wind and turning tide making taut the line that held her close to shore. The Venture, her rigging and her masts were scarcely visible, so somber was the night, lay ominously silent, expecting a murmur of voices from the cabin, abruptly aware of the passing of time and the approaching white cloud on the water that was the Mirabelle. The monkey sprang on the side of the open window and peered inside. A smoking lamp hung low over the center table, dropping a dusty round glow on the larger circle beneath it. Claggett Chew was blearily studying a paper spread out before him, leaning his ugly bear's skull on one hand. His eyes were bloodshot, and an empty wine bottle and glass holding only wine dregs showed he had been drinking and was now half asleep. Osterbridge Hawsey, in a heavy silk robe and embroidered slippers, lounged sideways in a chair with his legs hanging over the arm. His hand trailed an empty glass on the floor, and a silly drunken smile played over his face. "Claggett," he was saying, "is the place marked?" He hiccuped delicately. "Oh dear, the hiccups," he complained with a frown. "Let me have more wine." Claggett Chew did not reply nor rise to fetch another bottle. Osterbridge Hawsey gave a hiccup and spoke again. "Mark it, hic, Claggett. You may forget all those up walls to get over or hic under," he sighed. "Oh dear, hic. Think of those jewels, Claggett, hup. Devil take these hiccups," he exclaimed in a flurry of annoyance, but made no motion to change his comfortable position. "Claggett," Osterbridge Hawsey shrilled, "are you asleep or angry or hic? Put the cross there where the tree is, I say. I want those, hup, jewels, Claggett, and so do you, hic." Befuddled, his perception hopelessly blurred by excessive wine, Claggett Chew made a mark on the map. "There," he growled, his upper lip drawn back over his teeth. "Will that shut you up?" A moving shadow, duskier than the shadows themselves, came through the door and hovered over Osterbridge Hawsey. Claggett Chew suddenly started up. "I smell him," he muttered sickly. "He is here. Hollo? Night watchman," he shouted drunkenly. As he got up, stumbling and thrashing about in the uncertainty of his movements, his chair crashed on the floor and the monkey made a leap, cuffing the lantern from its hook. The light was dashed out, and in the dark, as he jumped, the monkey seized the creased, wellsome paper as he leapt back toward the pale square that was the window. Behind it, Claggett Chew's oaths and exclamations became fainter as the spicy scent grew stronger, and at last his muttering tail off into snorts and finally snores. The monkey, clutching the paper to itself, sat on the window ledge, stuffing it in the pouch around his neck, and a monkey smile flitted across his face as it heard the final dreaming sound from Osterbridge Hawsley.
"Hm, hic, jewels, hup," came from Osterbridge Hawsley.
Down the anchor rope scrambled the monkey with the agility and speed for which monkeys are famous. Mr. Wicker was already in the boat.
"How shall it be, sir?" came the low voice of Chris.
"Shall I become a beaver and go down and gnaw the rope of the anchor?"
"No," said Mr. Wicker.
"It can be more easily done than that, and nothing to trace it. Get in the boat. Here comes the Mirabelle." Taking his own shape once more, Chris saw the white ghost-like sides of the Mirabelle, soundlessly passing down the stream. Not a creak nor a splash of water came from her as she passed, but from the stern tiny light, struck by a flint perhaps, blinked once, and twice, and then a third time.
"Now," came Mr. Wicker's low voice,
"let me have my hand upon that rope." He only seemed to hold the anchor rope a moment, to give it an easy pull. The tugging strain was suddenly gone, and the Venture veered away like a frightened waterfowl.
"Will she go where she should, sir?" Chris wanted to know, leaning forward.
"That she will, Christopher," came the familiar voice in the dark, "and we must get out of her way, for here she comes down at us. The wind and the tide and, other forces will drive her solidly upon the bar. If I mistake not, it will be several days before they get her off." And on the night air, Chris heard a faint short chuckle.
"Pull, boy," his master told him sharply. "Here she comes." Chris grasped his oar and spun the boat only in time, for the down-floating tide and rising wind combined to drive the Venture forward at increasing speed.
The tide being still high, the ship was carried well upon the sandbar before it grounded, lolling over to one side, much like the sleeping sailors.
"Quick, lad, now we must catch the Mirabelle, and you and I must part."
"Oh, sir," Chris cried, holding his oar above the water. Mr. Wicker clapped Chris on the shoulder, and a glint of moonlight showed him to be smiling.
"I shall miss you too, my lad," he said.
"Now let us send this boat over the river as fast as she can go, and be in mind, keep your own shape at all times, unless you can change it out of the sight of prying eyes."
They pulled at the oars. "Oh yes, I nearly forgot. Among the effects placed in your sea chest, you will find a conch shell. Hold it to your ear, Christopher, as children do to hear the sea. You will be able to hear my voice, if you ever shall need to."
"Oh, like a walkie-talkie?" Chris asked, pulling at his oar.
"Somewhat,"
and Chris knew his master smiled at him.
"What about getting you to shore, sir?" Chris inquired, pulling in ribbon so that the rowboat flew down the black and silver river.
"Have you forgotten who I am, my boy?" he was asked in return.
"No, sir," said Chris, feeling a little small.
"Then undo the dinghy and climb up the side, for here we are," said Mr. Wicker, and the towering hull of the Mirabelle rose above them. Chris grasped a rope ladder that hung down beside them to the water's edge, and turned for a last word.
"I'll do my best, sir, but I hope you'll stay with me," he cried.
"All that I can, Christopher," came a distant voice. "Godspeed." And looking about, Chris made out, coasting on the air, a seagull balanced upon its black-tipped wings. Swallowing a lump in his throat that proved bothersome, Chris jerked at one oar and deftly coiled the magic rope over his arms, holding to the ship's ladder with the other. The signal flashed, a lantern swung in an arc, and dim figures waiting in their places howled on the lines. As Chris stepped to the deck over the side, the great white sails rose, spread, and bellied out from the three masts. Chris looked in wonder as the Mirabelle, proud as a woman, lifted up her head. Soon on the silent river only the dwindling sight of lonely sails was to be seen, heading toward Chesapeake Bay and then the sea, but anyone with eyes at good enough might have seen a solitary seagull following.
End of chapter 18. Recording by Ellie, August 2009.